welcome to Mine and Roman's Weekend Best.
We have got a cracking lineup for you today. We have gorgeous food, great guests, and some incredible musicians that you really don't want to miss.
Yeah, now our first guest today may have tragically died in Harry Potter, but has since been resurrected as a hugely successful author, illustrator, and comedian, Jessie Cave.
And after 15 years in Albert Square, he's swapping the gloomy East End for the bright lights of the West End. And a chilling new play is Jake Wood.
And of course, it will be Saturday without heading into the kitchen and rustling up some grub with our resident chef, Shivi Ramoutar.
Yeah.
Shivi, what are we cooking today?
So today we've got some simple summery sweet corn fritters. They're so versatile, you're going to love them.
Oh, my favourite.
Now, we always like to start this show with a little bit of a music question. So, which song was number one on this day in 2015? Okay, so think, end of July, 2015. Jessie, I'm coming to you. What were you doing at that point? 6 years ago.
Yeah, you've got to think about where you were, what you were doing to get this.
I'm going to fail at this. I'm really bad with music.
Go on, the first note that comes into your head.
How can I take that?
Steps.
Oh, that's Steps.
There you go, that's excellent.
No, Steps was great because also they had a reunion show, which I thought was last year. Jake, what about yourself?
I'm going to go...
you can't say Steps.
Little Mix.
Little Mix, that's a good shout.
Great. Dan?
I'm going to go the geezer who messed up your leg with a tattoo gun, Ed Sheeran, because he writes for everyone.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it wasn't that at all, which just reminded me of that terrible, terrible day. It was, of course... banger, Black Magic, which spent 3 weeks at number one back in 2015. Before its release, the song title was accidentally revealed on Twitter by Liam Pinnock's mum when she tweeted, hashtag mixers are excited for Black Magic. Yes, mixers. I'm pretty sure that would give it away. The tweet was, of course, swiftly deleted, and Leanne's mum, no doubt, but a little bit of a turn off. But it does lead me nicely into my first question. What's something that you've done before and you've just instantly regretted it? Jake, I'm going to come to you.
Instantly regret. Oh, I know this one. I was at a party once and I very stupidly asked... I was standing in the kitchen and I asked a woman when her baby was due.
Ooh!
Yeah, and she looked at me and she said, I'm not pregnant.
Ooh!
That was instant, yeah.
You never say that.
I've learned that.
Yeah, you had to learn that the hard way.
Going back quite a few years, I was a bit younger and... I thought I was being polite. But it didn't work out well. I spent the rest of the party just avoiding her.
Oh, that's like up there with the list
wasn't
of
good.
Things that are just
wasn't good.
That's ground sinking moment.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
oh my word.
Too happy. I could.
Oh my word, Jessie. What about you?
I did the classic liking an ex-girlfriend of my boyfriend's photo on Instagram. Obviously, I didn't follow her, so then I looked crazy for liking her photo out of the blue. So then I thought, okay, how do I rectify the situation? So I then followed her, and this all happened within about 30 seconds, and I screamed like I have never screamed before when I clicked like. I honestly, and my sister ran in, she thought something had happened, something dreadful, which it had, but...
How long ago is this?
This is about 4 years ago.
Oh, no, and it's still playing in your head.
It's just so easy to do, isn't it?
Yeah. Okay, that is, both of them are just absolutely horrendous.
Now, Jessie is starring in a brand new sitcom called Buffering about a group of millennials that have reached that stage in life when they're too old for clubbing but too young for a mortgage. That ring any bells?
Right? Speak for yourself, yeah.
Right. Jessie, great to have you here. You've got to tell me all about Buffering. It sounds absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, it's really good. It's written by Ian Sterling and Steve Bajaj, so lots of people know Ian from... He's the very funny voice of Love Island.
Of course.
And, yeah, this is his first lead acting role, maybe his first ever acting role, actually. And you would never know, because he's so good and he's so funny. And, yeah, we're just really lucky because everyone really liked each other and really got on, and I think it's quite an authentic group of friends.
Yeah, were you a big fan of Love Island before that?
Unfortunately, yes, a very big fan of Love Island still to this day.
So that was like a bonus?
Yeah, yeah. I've known Ian for a long time from comedy, so I do feel like I've cheated with getting this role because I think he just liked me and that's why I got it. and I got to wear my own glasses and stuff. So, but yeah, I would have done anything for him. He's great.
And we've actually got a clip of it. Let's take a look.
Okay, that confirms it. I'm playing my dead boss on Scrabble.
Do you want this one? Fine. Rosie, what makes you think you're playing your dead boss on Scrabble?
Well, at first, I just had a feeling. And then I thought, no, Rosie, you're mad. But then he played red. That was his nickname for me. No one knows why. And now he's just played coffee. And what does my boss always get from Starbucks in the morning?
Tea.
No, coffee.
I mean, I've never heard of Supernatural Scrabble before. I like it, though.
Yeah.
That sounds good. I'm actually more of a demonic Domino's guy.
What, is that the one with the jalapenos or that's pepperoni, that one?
Terrible. That's a terrible... That's, no, it's not what? A pizza. Move it on.
That pizza?
Anyway, look. now, recently, you have released your first ever book. Now, we've got it here. Sunset, which is a novel. Dad, you were saying how you like it, that it's a novel. It's not.
Well, no, I'm saying a lot of people come on here and they write like biographies, autobiographies, right? Which everybody's got their own story, haven't they? So it's kind of like a straightforward thing to do. But to write a novel, that's classy, in my opinion.
It's hard, isn't it? It's hard to write.
Yes, it's our graph.
Well, not just that. It's number one on the Times bestseller. I mean, congratulations, mate. That's fantastic.
It's quite hard. It's quite hard to write a novel. Maybe I regret that, actually. No, yeah. It was a lot of hard...
Was there an idea for the story, then?
Yeah, so it's about two sisters, and I'm really, really close to my sister. So it's kind of inspired by her, really, in our relationship. And, every year they go on holiday together. That's a kind of a ritual they have, but unfortunately, on one of the holidays, one of the sisters dies. So it's not a fun... It's not, you know... It's quite sad, the book, and I have made a lot of people cry. And I do feel really bad about that, and I keep getting messages, so I am sorry. But hopefully it's funny as well. And unfortunately, my brother died 2 years ago, so I have real-life experience of a sibling dying. And, I wouldn't have been able to do anything else, really. It was, like, an absolute need for me to write about something that is so personal to me and something that I don't think is very much talked about. It's not common to lose a sibling. Mm.
I mean, it's a whole family affair as well, because your mum designed the cover, right?
Yeah.
How did that happen?
Well, so my mum does all of... So me and Bibi do a podcast and all of our shows, like all of my live shows, my mum's always done the embroidery behind me, so whatever I stand in front of. And so this... I was allowed to design the cover, so she... I said, oh, can you make a sunset out of felt, which is what she always uses. So if you look closely, you can see that it's actually felt, which is something we've always used. And, I needed my mum and everyone to be involved in the whole thing.
Oh, man, I mean, how did Bibi feel being a character in the book?
Well, so, like, we're very much, like, both characters. We're a mix of both. And that was so great because I've only ever written about my own life and my own relationships. And so it was so great to finally be like, oh, I can just make stuff up. with this kind of root of truthfulness and so many of our traits are in the two sisters. I'm choosing our best bits and our worst bits and I'm just kind of throwing them together.
Yeah. So the podcast that you're doing, right, it's called We Can't Talk About That Right Now, but isn't that the whole point of a podcast, to talk about it all?
Well, I think it's coming back to the sister relationship and we talk about everything and we can talk about something so stupid like how many calories in a bag of peanuts and then we can be talking about death and, like, really serious topics, like, from within a minute. And it was a way of us just having it all out and it's so nice because it's been so bonding and especially in the horrible period of time that we've been through, it's just been so nice to... laugh and talk about stupid things, talk about Love Island, talk about, like, anything we like and we're interested by, but also quite often we fight and we, like, a lot of them, we've just had a massive fight and then we're going on a recording and you can see that we both, like, are red in the face from tears and almost just hate each other, or I've got a baby on me somewhere. It's very much us and you see us for what we are.
But you know what I like about it is the book and your podcast and all that. It sounds like as well, you know, that you're giving each other therapy. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You're looking after each other.
Yeah, and it's free.
Free
don't
therapy.
Have to pay for a therapist. Yeah, she's a very good therapist, and I'm a very good drill sergeant. So I think it's quite good. We meet halfway.
Yeah.
So she can be crying and I can be like, this is what you have to do, this is what you have to do. And then I can be like, but I'm... And she can just give me really nice, soft, caring advice.
It's not the first time you two have worked together, though, is it?
No, I use her in everything I do.
Yeah.
And
why
I
is that? Is that? Is it almost like a bit of a comfort blanket thing that, that sometimes...
Definitely.
My dad uses me as...
he won't leave me alone.
Yeah.
That's the trouble.
Yeah.
Basically, when I dropped out of art school, when I didn't know what I was going to do, I started making YouTube videos, and BB was available because she's 10 years younger and she was a teenager. So I was like, right, you're free. I don't have to pay you. Yeah. I'll pay you on the videos. And it's just kind of carried on. And I'm just really lucky to have her. And yeah. I think the age gap is quite good because we're not really competing yeah. with each other. So it's a little less frantic than being... you know, really close in age.
Oh. Yeah. Well, I mean, look, we've got to mention something massive as well. Harry Potter, lots of people grew up, you know, watching you as Lavender Brown in the films. I mean, how many people do you still have coming up to you now? Just shouting Expelliarmus to you, that's what I want to know.
Oh, my gosh, yeah. I mean, it's a whatever I do, the first comment underneath will be Expelliarmus or where's
really?
my 1-1.
No.
And that's okay, I don't mind it. When I dropped my kid off at school, when he was only really young, and I hadn't told him anything about Harry Potter, an older kid from the school saw me walking out and was like, Expelliarmus! And my son was just like, what does that mean? And so slowly, now that they're older, I'm explaining what Harry Potter is, and they watched it now and they know, you know, who I am and stuff, and they're really embarrassed, and they've watched them all, and I'm their worst thing about all the films.
No!
Like, which one's your favourite? Do you like the sixth one? Which one's your favourite? And they're like, no, we don't like the sixth one. The sixth one is the worst.
They'll love it when they're older, though. Yeah. It's that thing of they will absolutely cherish that. The amount of times that my dad tried to make me sit down and watch The Craze when I was 3 years old has actually done some really bad damage up here. Yeah. So maybe Harry Potter's a little bit better, a little bit easier.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what, you're not walking down the street with me, because all it'll be, Expelliarmus, gold! Expelliarmus, yeah. gold!
Yeah, I know.
Not coming with me.
No.
Jessie, so lovely to have you here. And we can see Buffering on ITV2 at 10 p.m. on Thursday, and Jessie's novel Sunset is out right now.
Yeah, time for a quick break, but when we're back, it'll be time to hide behind your sofas as Jake gives us the lowdown on his haunting new play.
And Shivi's in the kitchen rustling up a delicious sweet corn fritter. See you in a bit. Welcome back to Martin and Roman's Weekend Best.
Jessie Cave and Jake Wood are with us, and shortly we'll be heading into the kitchen for a lesson with our resident chef, Shivi. Mm. Now, on screen, he went by the name of Max Branning, serial womaniser, known for wreaking havoc in Albert Square. And in the 15 years he was there, he had a combined total of 13 marriages, relationships, extramarital affairs, accidentally ran over and killed his daughter, and was framed for attempted murder. What a life. But he's packed all of that in to tread the boards in a spine-chilling new play, and he's here to tell us all about it. Jake, so lovely to have you here, mate.
Thanks for having me.
Now, honestly, I always think that going to see a play, going to see a scary play, is way scarier than going to see a scary movie.
Yeah, yeah. I don't think I've seen that many scary plays. There are a couple, isn't there? Is it Ghost Story or...
Woman in Black haunted me as a kid.
Was it good? Yeah.
It absolutely haunted me as a kid. We had that, like, school... like, that was my school trip, and I will never forget that. But, look, your brand-new play, 222, Ghost Story. I mean, first question is, what's so scary about the number two?
It's... that's the time, 222. Yeah. So the basic premise is Lily Allen, Hadley Fraser are sort of a couple who've just had a baby, just moved into a house. In the process of doing it up, they invite me and they know us, another couple, Julia Chan and me. We come for dinner, and Lily Allen very early in the evening reveals that while the husband's been away, she can hear footsteps on the baby monitor walking around the cot, and it happens the same time every night, 2:22. So she persuades us to stay because she wants everyone to hear it. And that's sort of the beginning of the, you know, it's the beginning of the play, and then it's sort of, it's all set over one night, and various sort of things happen. I think if we do it right, it'll be sort of a gently terrifying night in the theatre.
Lovely, sort of, I can't wait.
It builds really nicely.
There's what some do you mean weird, gently which, terrifying? Oh, so like, so it's
or
just
maybe just terrifying.
Eeriness, yeah,
disturbing.
Yeah,
you can't go.
Oh, right? Okay, yeah, fine, yeah.
Yeah, because some people are really. I've talked to mates, and some people just say, oh, I can't come.
Yeah.
So it's a real divide about, you know, do you believe in ghosts or not?
How scary is it, though? So, OK, so here's Casper the Friendly Ghost. Here's The Exorcist.
we're going towards The Exorcist.
Okay.
We're going up.
All right, cool. All right, definitely can't go. are you a believer in the supernatural, though?
No, I'm sceptical, but open-minded, I think, Roman. And then in the process of researching the play, because I thought, well, I don't really believe in ghosts, what can I do? I went to a haunted house. I found a company on the internet that do these tours of haunted houses. So this was down in Greenwich. What's it called? Charlton House, I think it was called. Uh-huh. You go there at 10 o'clock. They give you a little talk. They show you all the little bits of kit they got. They got all these little bits of thing with lights. And
Ghostbuster that. Stuff.
Yeah, it was
still
interesting.
Still eerie,
but,
though, yeah.
But I came away, I sort of, yeah, it was spooky. There was a horrible feel in the house. Apparently, the house was haunted. And people that worked there wouldn't go up into the attic. And we spent a bit of time up there. It was weird. But you didn't see anything, but it just didn't feel right.
Felt wrong, yeah. I mean, it's quite the place to start for Lily Allen. I mean, she's starting her West End debut.
Yeah. Never acted before.
Never acted before. Yeah, I mean, amazing. Were you giving her tips?
She don't need any tips. Let me tell you, she's absolute natural. It's been a fascinating process and a real privilege, actually, to be in a rehearsal room and to watch her sort of acting for the first time ever. It's remarkable what she's done. And I think anyone coming to see is going to be blown away, honestly. Obviously, it's in the blood, and you know, she's and also performing music. I think, you know, she's obviously got it in some way. But yes, it's honestly, yeah, people are going to go. They're going to be blown away. So I'm really looking forward to it for her. And
good luck with that.
Thank you.
Good luck with that. We mentioned earlier that you made a scary decision to leave EastEnders after 15 years.
Yeah.
Why now? What brought that around?
I've been there 15 years, as you said. How many relationships on that show?
About 13.
About 13, yeah. I've been there 15 years. I took a year off about 5 years ago.
Yeah, I remember.
I just wanted to try something else. This is, you know, West End show. Name up in the West End, in lights for the first time ever. Yeah. So I'm excited to do some other stuff. So look, never say never. They've kept the door open. I'm very pleased. The character's not dead. So the door's always there. But I think for the moment, I just want to enjoy a bit of downtime, which I've done with the family. Love that. And do some other stuff.
They must really not like you if they kill off your character, isn't that right, Dad? You know what I mean? I mean, how bad would that be? You know what I mean, they're keeping the door open for Jake. Imagine that, being shut out from a show that you work so hard on. Look, it is fair to say, though, that obviously, you know, Max Brang, one of the biggest and best characters that Albert Square has seen over so many years. Mm. But the fan base is pretty huge as well.
Yeah.
Now, they love Max so much that they've done things like this. Look at that tattoo. I mean, that tattoo, I don't know if it's Max Brang or Phil Mitchell too, or Ross, or Ross Kemp.
It's an amalgamation, isn't it?
Hang on, if I do that, it's probably...
Yeah, exactly. But, I mean, know where that is on this man's body?
Yeah, he's got it on his
bum. I've got some rogue tattoos, but I'd love to have seen the moment when he's gone into the tattoo parlour and said, "Did you watch EastEnders last night?" Well, Jake, in honour of your new spooky role, I thought we could see how well you know your ghosts in a little quiz we're calling... Who Ghost There? What a name that is.
Yeah.
I'm on fire. Now, in fact, everyone can play this game, OK, including you watching. The winner will get to take home this. The Weekend Best Ghost Trophy.
Hey.
Oh, yeah.
Woo!
Now, as is a ghost trophy, only comes out at night, but trust me, very much real. Okay, so let's keep this.
Come on.
Oh, sorry. Put it there.
You dropped it.
Sorry. Right, so I'm going to ask you all a series of supernatural-based questions. All you have to do is write down your answers on the boards that you have there. Whoever gets it right wins a point, and the person with the most points at the end gets a trophy. Right. Does that sound good, guys?
Great. Yep.
Okay. Here we go. What is a fear of ghosts called? Ooh, so the fear of ghosts. Is this something that you have, Jessie? I had no idea about this, but this is a very good new word for me. Okay, can I see your answers, please? Gustobia. Polyamory?
I obviously know it's not that, sorry.
Oh. You fall in love with many ghosts.
many ghosts.
Many ghosts. Spectrophobia. Like seeing things.
Oh, that's good.
Scared of seeing things. Mm. Okay, I can actually reveal the answer is phasmophobia.
Phasmophobia.
Oh, I've got a phobia, right?
Yeah, Jake, I quite like. I'm going to give you that point, actually. Spectrophobia is pretty good. I like that. Right, next one. Fill in the blanks from these Ghostbuster lyrics. If there's something blank in your blank, who are you going to call Ghostbuster? If there's something blank in your blank, who are you going to call Ghostbusters? You should know all this. OK, going to have to rush you.
Yeah, go on.
Everyone show your answers, please. Wrong in the car. Wrong in the neighbourhood.
If there's something strange
in the neighbourhood.
Yeah.
Let's
Who
take a look.
Call?
It is a neighbourhood! Well done. Although, if there's something wrong in your car, call it. Yeah, call Quick Fit. Yeah. Perfect. I like that answer as well. OK, so let's go to. What is the name of the ghost in Harry Potter that haunts the girls' bathroom? Now, if you get this one wrong, Jessie,
I know, this would be really bad.
Yeah. And if you write polyamory on this, I don't know either. What is the name of the ghost in Harry Potter that haunts the girls' bathrooms? OK. Jake, Dad, you got your answers ready?
Yeah.
All right. Let's have a look, please, guys. Bob.
Force it.
Moaning Myrtle. Let's take a look. It is Moaning Myrtle. Very good. Very good. Force it. That's a good gag from you. It's not bad.
Get it?
Yeah, I got it, yeah.
I thought it might have gone over your head.
No. I've just intentionally forgotten it. right. Next up. The most accurate depiction, according to myself, will win this. You have 15 seconds to draw Casper the Friendly Ghost. Go. Whilst we wait for the guys to finish their drawings, let's remind ourselves of how much of a wonderful film that was and how much the end. Didn't it look very similar to the Backstreet Boys video? Backstreet's back. All right.
Right.
And three, two, one.
Hey!
That's out.
Why is it?
That's out instantly. That looks like a Mr. Men character.
It is.
Right, OK, so that's Casper.
Hang on a second. You're winding me up. That's a spit image. That's a spit.
No, Dad, sit down, you're out. I'm actually... OK, Dad, you can help me with this.
Yeah.
Have a look at these. Because whoever wins this wins overall. Now, the reason I'm not going to get...
Shall I tell you,
I didn't draw arms, so I feel like you should.
Yeah, and I'll tell you what, Jake, I think you've gone with the Hollywood depiction with no legs.
Yeah, the Hollywood one.
Yeah, I like that.
Who are we going with?
I'm going with Jake, I've got to.
I love the face, but I'm going to have to go with Jake. Well done.
Yay.
Well done. And Jake, here you go.
Beautiful.
Hang on.
I'll treasure that. Thank you, boys.
Oh! Sorry.
There you go, I got it.
I'll get you another one.
Don't worry about it.
We'll get you another
there
one.
There we go, yeah. I'll treasure it.
Sorry about that. very good, Jake. Thank you so much for being here today, mate.
Thank you for having me, yeah.
Yeah, man. And you can book tickets for 2:22, A Ghost Story Now.
Yeah, now after the break, we're heading to the kitchen to join our in-house chef, Shivi, who's making some lovely summery sweet corn fritters.
See you in a few minutes. Mine and Roman's weekend best.
Yep, we've moved to our kitchen with our resident chef, the ravishing Shivi Ramoutar.
Shivi, looking beautiful today.
Thank you.
Nice to see you. Shiv, it's my turn to cook this week.
Mm-hmm.
There's...
Something missing?
Some ingredients missing, I'm hoping.
No.
I'm just saying there's veg.
You know what
And that's
right
chopped
right
veg.
Now.
You know I love to pack you in with your five a day, Ro. You know, you're not getting it anywhere else, so it's get it in the weekend best kitchen. But actually, no, it's my favourite time of the year. The produce coming out this season is just so vibrant and sweet and delicious, and we are going to celebrate them with my simple summer fritters and a tomato salsa.
Ooh!
Shivi simple summer fritters.
See, I love a fritter with a cold beer.
OK, all right.
Love that.
Well, there you go. I've got a beer ready for you. It's not. It's oiled. Please don't drink that.
No, I won't.
That's a joke. Okay. Shiv, should we get started?
Where do we start? We should start with our fritter batter.
Okay. Now, when I hear the word batter in you, all I think is wet hand, dry hand.
No wet hand, dry hand.
No wet hand, dry hand.
This is so easy. Honestly, it's a one mix in a bowl jobby. It's great. It's so easy. A kid can do this.
I never know whether or not to be offended when you say that this one's really easy.
You know what?
Or if I've gotten away with it.
No. Cooking doesn't need to be complicated, right? And it's not because of anybody's skills. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. It is just supposed to be easy and enjoyable and delicious. And as you're seeing here, we're just throwing stuff in a bowl. We've got 400 grams of sweet corn drained from a tin. You can also use cooked sweet corn, and you just make sure you just swipe off the kernels in there. I've got half a grated courgette. I've got 4 spring onions that I'm going to snip right into the bowl. Scissors? See, it's not even any chopping in this fritter batter recipe.
Love this.
Okay, so we've got our gorgeous veg, and then can I just say, I'll remind you again, this is all beautiful seasonal veg. It's the time to be eating your sweet corn, your courgette, your spring onion, your tomato. This is it. So going into here as well, I've got 4 heaped tablespoons of flour. And do you know why I love a fritter? Not only saying the word fritter or fritter batter, it's a great place to throw in random bits of veggies. Ram it in there because people will eat it, even if they're vegophobes like Ro. Spinach. I could have added spinach in here. I still loved it.
I don't know about you, right? You definitely don't, because you're a chef.
Yeah.
Do you ever get flour phobia?
What on earth do you mean, Ro?
You go into the shop. No, a lot of people know what I'm saying. You go into the shop and you know all you've got to do is you've got to get flour. Yeah. Then I get there, rice flour, wheat flour, whole wheat flour, self-raising flour. Flour that used to be under a tin. flour that needs to be flour.
Stone flour.
What? So what's this? Is this just plain flour?
Right. Yeah, for me, you can also use self-raising. It's not a problem here. Just stick with the plain and self-raising. There's no need to go overcomplicated or too fancy in this. So as well as our plain flour we've got in here, I've also got 2 beaten eggs, 2 teaspoons of paprika, a lot of seasoning. This will take a lot of seasoning, and also 6 tablespoons of milk.
Okay.
And that is that. And that goes
again,
in.
Again, milk phobia.
Don't even start.
Milk, plain milk, skim milk, full fat. What's the point?
Life is becoming more complicated, isn't it? It just used to be flour, butter, eggs, sugar.
Yeah. Sorry, because I'm unsimpling this. Yeah.
All right, so do you know what? Fritters are brilliant because this is going to be a Saturday supper, right? But it can also be brunch, breakfast, lunch, dinner. Throw on fried chorizo, bacon. You can make it what you like. It's such a versatile dish, and it's so easy to throw together. So give it a good mix. And as I said, if you want to swap out any of the veg, the half a courgette, you can throw in a massive handful of peas, you can throw in spinach. It is really a good way to cram in your 5 a day. And as I know, this is the time where Ro eats the best veg, is when he's here at Weekend Best, right?
Yeah. Mine's 5 a week.
All right.
One of my 5 a week.
Now,
get it once.
But look at this. Cheers. We've got sweet corn, we've got tomato, we've got spring onion, we've got courgette. 4 of your 5 a day, right?
Very good.
So, can I just talk about the batter? Now, you'll notice it's not too runny, it's not too stodgy, it's Goldilocks batter, it's just right.
Yeah.
And it's a dollop like that. That is the kind of fall you want. If you have it too runny, it's going to struggle to come together, and if it's too stodgy, it's just not nice to eat. So it's a Goldilocks batter you just made there. Our frying pan is on a medium heat, 2 tablespoons of vegetable oil heating up in there. Now, we're going to fry the batter. All of the hard work is done, right? Mix everything together. Now we're going to fry it. About 2 tablespoons per fritter. Just going to go right into the middle. Oh, sizzle, sizzle. Now this is where...
2 tablespoons per...
fritter.
Per fritter.
Yes. Okay. And then you're just going to shape it out a little bit. You can get all fancy here by having a greased cookie cutter, and you can put the batter into the cookie cutter if you want to make it perfect. But I think the beauty is in asymmetric, rough around the edges. Rose word rustic comes
to mind.
So
you could have a gingerbread man.
I have done that.
I'm just saying.
Gingerbread fritter.
Yeah.
So this is going to take about 5 minutes to cook. We're going to flip it over halfway through, and it should be golden and cooked through, which gives us time to make our salsa. If you are making a lot of these, which we are, you can pop your oven on to about 100 degrees, and once they've been drained on your kitchen roll, you can just keep them warm in the oven. Which is what we're doing, right?
Yeah. Yep.
So we can have a massive stack of gorgeous fritters. Ooh. And in the meantime, you can make the salsa that's going to top it.
Okay.
So for the salsa, we've got 2 juicy tomatoes that we're going to chop. I've also got 1 lime, 1 spring onion, and a little bit of parsley and half a clove of garlic. So for this simply, let's just chop our tomato row. That fritter smelling incredible.
I know, so
good. It's something that's sort of, my mouth is already watering.
See, I'm even... Why is it when I come here, I just, even, like, simple things that I do at home, I have to watch her do it first?
Yeah. Like,
so she's got the smart sense. She is... she is chopping it. She is chopping
it. Do you know what? Even me, you know, you kind of think, ah, everybody's watching me chop a tomato. No, you know, it's... You know I'm watching you like a hawk crow, that's why.
Do you know what I like, Shiv?
Yes.
I like the old vine tomatoes.
Yes.
Like, when Shirley comes back from the shops, if she's got those vine tomatoes, I can't wait to pick one off and just... stuff it down.
They are just so sweet.
Yeah, and beautiful.
It is beautiful, and because we're in the season of tomatoes now, I will keep going on about this throughout this little segment. The fruit and the veg, because obviously tomatoes are fruit, if we're going to be all technical, it's just at its peak. It is gorgeous. Oh. It's the time to eat these things. Although saying that, this fritter, as you know, I love a freezer, this fritter will freeze beautifully, so you can do a whole stack of them and pop them into a resealable freezer bag, separate the fritters with greaseproof paper, and then they can be cooked, reheated from frozen.
Am I just chopping these up as is? Great.
Quick chop. Let's grate in half a clove of garlic. And it's great to have this ready to go because, you know, right now it's summer holidays, a lot of people have kids running around. It's a bit of a nightmare to always be making fresh food from fresh. So this is a brilliant one for a lunch, brunch, breakfast, as all of those meals are in between, snacks, throw a poached egg on it, chorizo on it, bacon on it.
That's it. This is a very good in-between meal.
Yeah. So in goes the spring onion. Ro, do you want to check your fritter?
Yep.
Just give it a little look. It should be nice and golden. I don't know if you can see mine from here.
There you go. Grate that in there for me. Yeah.
Now, what I always suggest with salsas is it's really worthwhile doing them at least 10 minutes ahead of time because you need that time for the flavours just to meld together, right? You need them to just come together with the seasoning. So I'm going to throw in quite a lot of salt and pepper. So if you can do it ahead of time, definitely worthwhile doing. And if you want, you can add avocado in this, you can add chilies in this. That is smelling gorgeous. Now just a bit of lime. Now you remember, Martin, you know the trick for releasing the lime juice?
Yeah, you cut it.
Roll it first.
Roll it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Trick for the lime juice. What? Yeah, you cut it.
What's happened to the weeks of training?
What else are you doing? Squeezing it as well, huh? Oh, yeah, that's quite a good one.
Yeah, but what about my little trick where you squeeze it in your fist so you stop the pips from going?
Yeah, that is a good one. That was the one. I know that you had a tip and that's your there citrus you tip. Amazingly, I seem to have a pip-free lime. So I'm going to make it super limey because the lime works so well with the sweet corn and the paprika. The flavours are just insane together. Ah, that is looking great. Your fritter is looking brilliant, Ro.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Yeah, it is as well.
Yeah, that. Brilliant.
So
yeah,
really. Let's just give this a nice big stir and that salsa is going to be perfect atop of that fritter. I'm going to pop the parsley aside here because that is going to top the fritter again to make it look beautiful. I'm just going to set this aside. Look at that. Gorgeous.
Oh, wow.
I'm just going to pop that fritter on the kitchen towel line plate. Pop that aside here. And now I can go and get the other fritters that have been warming in the oven.
Oh, Ro, it looks really good.
That looks fantastic, Ro. Oh, gosh, that's a nice meaty fritter. So the other fritters of yours, Ro, are just keeping warm in the oven, so just grab those. Now, this, I think, looks spectacular, stacked up with the salsa falling off the top of it. I'm going to start with this one on the bottom.
Oh. Oh, man, this is going to be wonderful.
I know, it is a wonderful little dish. As I said, you can go to town with your toppings, a fried egg on top, or poached egg if you're being a bit fancy. And
this... Great, that's better than some veggie burgers I've had.
Yeah, it's a good, it's a really good one, and it is. Do you know what?
You're saying that because I made the veggie burgers that week on here.
No, I'm just saying.
Is that what you're saying?
No, I'm just saying it looks.
I was just checking. I was just checking.
Now, just let that salsa cascade over the top and down the side of this fritter. Oh, this is my kind of summer eating. It is light. It's filling, but it is light and it is fresh.
Yeah.
You know, and it's full of gorgeous colour, which for me is what it's all about. Summer eating is all about that. Lovely freshness.
It's like a pancake stack.
Yeah, it is. A savoury pancake stack. And this will make perfection of a supper. Really, and it, you know, look how quick and simple it is to throw together.
Do you know what's wonderful as well, Shiv, is the colour. The colour is so vibrant. It's superb.
This is rainbow food at its best.
Really?
And it's summer seasonal produce at its absolute best. And here we have simple sweet corn fritters with a tomato salsa.
Oh, wow.
Look at that.
Hang on. Let's get this going.
Oh, I love the thought and effort, the styling. You're really styling it up.
Oh, yeah, right. I'm getting a styling going here, shit.
Honestly,
yeah.
That is a
look
proper
at that.
Oh, look at that one.
Look at that.
Thank you very much.
Even the way you put it down, you know, flick of the wrist.
Service!
<you
go. laughs>
Let's have a taste, then.
Yeah, you want to go?
So, yeah, definitely.
These look phenomenal.
And would you believe each portion is about 75 pence?
So the whole thing?
The whole thing, and it's full of so much of your five a day.
That is amazing.
This is phenomenal.
Delicious.
I love Absolutely. The salsa as well. Really, really nice.
Yeah. For all the details on how to make Shivi's simple summer fritters, head over to itv.com/food. Looking forward to seeing you again next Saturday.
Absolutely. Can't wait to come back.
Very good. And we'd love to wear your aprons on the show, so email us your ideas to weekendbest@cactustv.co.uk.
Right, time for a break, but don't go anywhere because we're going to be meeting our Weekend Best VIP.
Plus, we've got some more top TV and film recommendations coming your way. See you in a bit.
See you in a bit. Roman's Weekend Best. Jessie Cave and Jake Wood keeping us company all morning.
Yes, indeed, Jake.
So good, by the way.
Enjoyed that? Lovely. Now, if you're looking for some fantastic TV or film recommendations, then look no further, because here is our best picks.
My pick is the new series of Undercover Big Boss on ITV. Now, it's a revamped version of the classic Undercover Boss. And just like before, right, we're going to get to see company executives leaving their offices and gracing the shop floors of their very own businesses at a time when companies are facing the toughest ever challenges. Let's take a look at this.
Been in the business 20 years, but I have never done a customer-facing role.
In our business, if we don't get it right, it's failure.
I'm the king of this industry.
That's the reason for going undercover like we're doing now. Let's have a
think you'll be buying from us today?
No.
Okay.
He's not a born salesman.
So good.
Great show, love that. Undercover Big Boss starts Thursday at 9 p.m. on ITV.
Yeah, now my pick this week is Disney's newest blockbuster, Jungle Cruise, which is based on one of the rides at Disneyland. I mean, why not? They've made a story about everything else. It's a comedy starring Emily Blunt, Jack Whitehall and Dwayne The Rock Johnson, who I'm still thinking will one day be the president of the United States.
Yeah.
I think it will happen.
Cool.
The film's been described as Pirates of the Caribbean meets Indiana Jones, and you can see why. Here's a clip of Emily Blunt and The Rock in action.
Sightseeing. How nice of you to join us.
Oh,
no. That's like a proper film.
Well, do you know what? I've spoken to Jack about this, right? And he said that The Rock, they were filming out in like the middle of the rainforest, and The Rock had to get like shipped in an actual like football pitch sized gym.
Did he?
For every day, where at 2 o'clock in the morning, he gets up and works out for 2 hours before the film. Imagine that. I mean, he's massive. Look at the size
amazing.
Of him.
Amazing.
Exactly. He's a Disney character in himself. Yeah. Jungle Cruise is out in cinemas now. Now, guys, Jessie, Jake, you've both picked the same show.
Yeah.
We've never had this before.
Must be good, then.
It must be very good.
It is good. I've seen it, and it's brilliant.
You guys have picked Succession. Jessie, how would you describe Succession?
I would describe it as a story about four siblings who are... all want to be the successor of their father's empire of a news corporation. I am addicted. I watched it. I've watched it twice. Both series, and I adore every single character, even though you hate them at first. I just love it.
I love these types of shows. Let's take a quick look.
He's our dad, but he was going to send me to jail. He'd do the same to all of us.
Shivi, you okay?
Are you part of this family or not?
If I back you against Dad, you would need to let me take over.
Whoa, Nelly.
Ask yourself, do you want to be on the side of good or evil?
Oh, what a show. I'll tell you what. That is some of the best acting I've seen on television for so long. Yeah.
Brian Cox in that is unbelievable.
Oh, unbelievable. Yeah. Wow. Deserves every accolade he gets.
You can catch Succession on Sky. Some fantastic recommendations in there.
Yeah, right. Time now to meet another Weekend Best VIP. That is very interesting person. Well, this week, very interesting people.
Yeah, our VIP guests prove it's never too old to pursue a new passion. A few years ago, pensioners Pete and Baz had never heard of grime or drill music, but after giving it a go, they released their breakout hit, Dents in a Peugeot, which has had over 1.8 million hits on YouTube, and it's brilliant. Pete and Baz, welcome to the show!
Hey.
How are we doing, guys?
Pete, I'm going to come to you first, mate. I mean, Pete, how did you go from being two blokes who had never heard of drill music before to, you know, years later being professional recording artists?
Professional recording artists? Well, it's my granddaughter. She mucks about with my car radio and I kept mucking about back with it, and then she mucked about with it, and in the end I left it, and we thought, this ain't too bad. And this young man come up with the idea of putting out our first one, which...
Yeah, we gave it a go. We thought, well, you know, let's see if people like this.
Yeah.
And it was a bit of a surprise, to be honest.
Yeah, very much a surprise.
And then we thought we'd do another one, didn't we?
Well, it's very good. I mean, and look, we love the tune as well. The music video is fantastic. I want to take a quick look at it. Here it is, Dents in a Peugeot. Let's take a look.
Back then I had dents in a Peugeot. Now I got chains in the chest. Gold, one on each finger. Brand new range in the shed. Back then I had dents in a Peugeot. Now I got chains in my chest. Gold, one on each finger. Brand new range in the shed.
So good!
Yeah, that's a good video, that. You see that black Range Rover there? That's been on to Tammy Abrams.
Tammy Abrams, the Chelsea footballer. So how have you ended up with Tammy Abrams? And does he know about it?
Well, I knocked on his door and I said, can I buy a Range Rover? And he said, do you want a black one or a white one?
Which is a true story.
Yeah, it's a true story, yeah. And I thought I'd come and get lost because I don't know him that well.
Yeah. I did hear that you guys are even more famous abroad, right? Because you keep getting recognised when you go on the continent.
Well, I thought we did, didn't we? I was smashing that boy. Tell them about that policeman.
What happened? You were in Iron Upper?
Yeah. Just before the COVID, we were on the last festival there.
What happened in Iron Upper?
Well, OK.
Oh, what goes on in Iron Upper station?
We put a week's holiday into one day.
Yeah.
So we were going down the high street on these little scooters,
electric
scooters, and we're screaming as fast as they were going, and suddenly we heard the Blues and Two. We thought, what have we done wrong? A scream ran in front of us.
Yeah.
Get out of their car,
putting
their batons in their pockets.
The way locked up, here we are.
Yeah, we thought, hello, we were in right lot of trouble here.
Trouble.
And when they come up, they said, guys, can we have selfies?
Love that.
Yeah.
Love that. I thought you were going to be in a new episode of Banged Up Abroad.
No.
Hey, lads, so you're going back out on tour in the autumn, isn't that right?
Yeah. We got a big tour starting here.
Yeah,
we don't want to plug it too much because it pretty much sold out.
Yeah.
Well,
let's get a picture of my armpit there. That's not nice, isn't it? You don't show that on television.
Before that, though, next month, Brighton.
I've got to ask, right? Pete and Baz on tour, what can people expect from these types of shows? Does it get rowdy? Is it mellow vibes? What's it like?
Yeah. You have never seen rowdy like it because it was pretty rowdy before. But you imagine these poor guys have been banged up for 2 years and we're like an overwhelmed watch. We are. We're just ready to spring into action and we are just going to give it to
them. Oh, yeah, absolutely. From the minute this curtain goes up...
You will see nothing like...
2 or 3 hours after the curtain goes down.
I'll
tell you, boys, I wouldn't like to be in the middle of your mosh pit.
Be very sweaty and very smelly.
I'll tell you what, do you reckon you could give us a few bars of Dent in your Peugeot?
Back then had dents in a Peugeot. Now you're chains in my chest. Gold, one on each finger. Brand new range in the chest.
Yay!
Lads, you are some of our favourite VIPs that we've had on this show. Thank you so much for joining us today. Let's hear it for Pete and Baz, everyone.
Yeah, Pete and Baz. Hey, that's your lot for today. But if you fancy watching us all over again or missed any of the show, catch up now on the ITV Hub.
Thank you so much to our guest, Jessie Cave.
Jake Wood.
Yes.
And of course, Shivi.
We're back tomorrow with an incredible lineup: Tom Allen, Ramesh Ranganathan, and Bill Bailey. We won't get a word in.
No, we won't. See you tomorrow.
See you guys.